factors that you need to consider that are above the standard setup when trying to sound the gas. And hopefully we can cover any of your questions. He's given us the room for a couple hours, but hopefully we'll just get to the meat of the matter quickly and get on out of here. I'm here at your disposal, but jump in during the presentation if you have something that triggers a thought so that everyone can also pick up on the question and the clarifications. Our IP multiplexers come in a couple different models. The upper one is really based on our legacy TDM multiplexer that uses the T1 or E1 TDM controllers. But with the replacement of the controller in that shelf, the entire multiplexer becomes Ethernet aware, and you can then stream your existing modules over IP connectivity. The one shown on the bottom is the original IP multiplexer that Interplex introduced. It has both T1, E1 interfaces as well as internal TDM buses, and is intended for migration or TDM to IP conversion of T1 lines pass-through and or termination. So it will do both. They can connect and stream onto the T1 connected landlines or telecom connections, as well as convert those time slot by time slot to IP, or the entire T1 can just be converted to a Ethernet stream and distributed to another site. Just a little architectural background so you understand why we are TDM. Well, I guess the reason is because of the T1 world that we came from and the legacy inventory of modules that we have to convert various services from the synchronous or asynchronous data to various styles of audio up to broadcast quality, full 48 kilohertz sample FM quality. Audio transport, we have a wide variety of installed modules, and those modules can then be reprovisioned and used on Ethernet connections. 64 kilobit per second time slot is based on the TDM sampling rate of 8 kill samples per second. That 8,000 times per second is our frame rate that's referred to in our stream construction. So every sample off the bus is a byte out of a time slot, and a lot of times those are contiguous time slots, so you can pick up a group of voice channels all together at the same time and bundle those into the single stream that you're trying to construct. Adjacent time slots are necessary in order to build a stream. So modules in the system need to be programmed to be in adjacent time slots to efficiently build a stream. There's a lot of ways to construct the streams, and hopefully we'll cover some of those various combinations for you. Differences in the systems, though, are that the introductory NetExpress system has 4 internal TDM buses and 2 line interfaces. So there are 6 TDM sources or destinations in the box that can then be connected to each other or to the IP world. The NetExpress LX, which is based on an N-terminal multiplexer, the N-terminal multiplexer would have normally terminated 1 TDM bus, so there was room for 1 T1's capacity in the shelf. If you drop in a CM30 controller, you now have double that capacity. Bus architecture on the existing shelves is designed also for drop and insert operation, where a T1 would have been arriving from 2 directions, or so you could do a pass through from a site to 2 T1s, but when the IP controller is in there, it gives you access to twice that bus capacity for a single terminal. So you can expand in capacity. So long as you have slot space for modules in the system, you can actually free up some rack space off them by the introduction of the IP controller into an existing multiplexer. When someone orders one from the factory, we will supply the factory with information on where the ordered modules are to be installed into the shelf. And this is a typical sheet for someone with 12 channels of audio. Each of those voice modules, the voice frequency, -25 is the standard E&M 4-wire audio module that we produce. Module adapters can be selected to interface that to the outside world, presenting a connection to a 30-pin telecom block, or the MA306 is actually each channel presented on its own 8-conductor RJ connection. So for just one or two channels, that's a lot simpler to deploy than breaking up to a punch block and then connecting onward from there. For low channel counts, that makes a lot of sense. Also the Simulcast module, so this is the prime site, the main control point box that will go into someone's deployment. And so it's got 4 channel cards installed in the 12 slots of the system. The backplane has room for 12 channel modules in it of the conventional TDM module architecture. And it's broken up into 2 bus groups, TDM bus 1 and TDM bus 2. Each channel card on it can be selected to go to the primary bus as a normal terminal multiplexer selection, or the alternate bus, bus B. So that gives you 2 buses in each of 2 physical card group carriers in the system. It's important to remember where your money is sitting in the bus in order to connect the streaming service onto that and properly bring the end-to-end connectivity. For a new system, right out of the box, the first thing to do is power up each unit and connect onto it at the default IP address of the management interface and assign the WAN ports to deployable addresses that you want to connect to, or at least to differing addresses on a common subnet so that you can bench test or stage the entire system. But first log into the management and change the WAN, which is the streaming interface, to a unique address so that you can then interconnect them all. If a chassis will be connected onto a network and it sees its own duplicate IP address, that interface on the box you saw at first will actually back out of the way so as not to cause network congestion or interference. It'll recognize that the IP address is already in use, get out of the way, and it will not come back up to cycle the chassis again. So you need to reassign that IP address. It doesn't want to step on existing services if someone inadvertently plugged in a duplicate address on the network. So you want to install your channel modules if they didn't come from the factory already laid out as you designed. Select them for remote control operations so that you can then manage them from the controller interface on the system and then keep track of where you assign their actual time slots to be presented. The physical slot position is only going to affect which bus the system can access, the channel card can access, excuse me. But if they're in remote control operation, then you can select which time slots in that bus they land on and how many consecutive time slots they'll consume. So for each card, by having it in remote control, you can then manipulate whether it's on the A or B bus within that bus range or bus physical access range, bus number 2. And then select the time slots so that they can be efficiently adjacent to other services in the shelf so that you can make a bandwidth efficient stream. Skipped time slots someplace, then you'll end up transporting the idle time slots out to the field in order to encompass all of your services efficiently. Each stream is going to have its own IP overhead added for destination and encapsulation method information, and that's excess bandwidth on top of the 64K bandwidth per time slot that the streams are going to need. And then activate the streams and connect the services. From the module adapter on the back of the system, depending on what type of interface you're presented with, your physical connections will be made up to the chassis. From there, that'll connect through to whatever channel card is ahead of that. This would also apply if this is the GPS reference coming in the back plane into the MA480. Then physically has to meet up with the Simulcast module ahead of that. And each of the channel cards then deposits that in a TDM format onto the bus on the back of the system. Connecting that to the destination out the field is the job of the stream process. So the virtual stream is just to establish the TDM connectivity to an IP destination and to also receive that at the opposite side and decode it onto a matching module. Everything is done for managing the system using web browser or with SNMP control. The NetExpress is completely SNMP aware. It is not an S&MP accessibility overlay. The architecture of the NetExpress is S&MP root with the web browser overlay above that. So every functioning system is S&MP possible. Create streams from script. You can simply edit the script and re-import those streams onto the system. But it's a different architecture. A lot of products will have the remote control added as an after feature or an accessory. This is S&MP based down at the core level. To connect to the NetExpress then with the web browser, you'll want to first migrate the PC onto the common subnet of the management interface. By default, that is an address of 192.168.1.1. We typically recommend use .10, I don't want, but that's a common number we've been using for years, and it's migrated into the documentation. When you first try to access the IP address of the management interface, it will challenge you with a lot of data. And the default admin, in fact, cannot be changed from the login name of admin. We don't have a table in there. The ability to change the password itself. So it's not quite as secure as it could be if we actually allow you to expand the username, but the default login name will always be that when you meet up with this challenge from the NetExpress. And then you're at the home page of the system in the browser, which shows you a summary of hopefully the chart, the channel modules located where you intended them to be physically deployed. This perspective of the system comes from the fact that the channel cards have an address assigned to them. They could be plugged into the shelf and have the wrong address set on the module, whereby they'll be presented in a different order in the web presentation, because that's the only way it knows physically where that flat bus is holding its various modules. But if done right, then our Simulcast card does show up as our first physical slot, and the first six physical slots give us access to TDM1, and they can then therefore access 1A or 1B, depending on how we set up the program. Beyond slot 6, card would be on TDM bus 2, A or B, depending again on how you set it. There's a switch on each of the channel modules that permits remote control operation or not. Remote is not illuminated green here. The card is set for manual mode. And you can then configure the module only with the DIP switches on the card, which is fine. They will still present their information onto the TDM bus, and you can stream from them, but you won't be able to then manipulate those assigned time slots or bus settings or other channel card information like channel range, signaling, enable, disabled by the software. If the card has an alert on it, or you have a new module, such as the DA212 that we just introduced, the web browser interface doesn't have a template yet in the current code to recognize that module. It may show the card, if assigned to a physical slot address, as a question mark on the dialog here. You can still configure the card manually and connect it by streaming, and it will function as long as it's not interfering with another channel card that's in the shelf. So we have provision for legacy modules or future modules in the system by means of the card address being presented and yet not having a remote control window for it yet in software. If you try to launch the software window to configure a card, normally you would just click on the open button at the bottom of the module and it will pop up and say unrecognized module. Quite often on a new card, just set the SCD address to 0. That doesn't give it a physical view anywhere in this, so there's no confusion. You know it's in there, you can stream to it, but it doesn't distract from the physical presentation of the shelf. Okay, so each module will have its own style of interface depending on the capabilities of the specific module. Here we'll launch the voice module for channel audio card. And of prime interest is that the card be enabled if it's intended to encode. It doesn't need to be enabled. The BF25 card can still receive information and play out audio in the off or non-enabled mode. So you can install a redundant module in the system and decode from the same time slot multiple times and play out the backplane, which is kind of handy for troubleshooting. If you suspect that there's a module in error, making some distorted resulting audio, you can introduce a working module into the shell on the same time slots but not enabled so that it doesn't conflict with anything, and play that onto another piece of test equipment without interrupting the existing connections. And that allows you to actually listen to the audio presented there and see if it's actually coming off the bus or the screen that way. If it is, then you know it's not the local card at fault, it's happening further on the screen than this module. But this gives us the point of starting the stream connection. Here's where you would assign the TDM time slot and bus direction to present the information from this module. So if it is enabled, you can encode and pick up outbound traffic from this card, set the number of time slots that this channel card is to consume. We normally leave it fully turned on unless you have other services of different nature that need to show up on those next time slots. But all of us are able here, and we would only stitch up the ones we want to from the screen side. Level controls are also available here. When you first install the module, the levels will be naturalized to a one-to-one in a matching level. Loopback tests are also available here. But this is getting away from the streaming function. Once we've assigned the time slots on a card, in the menus, this is the expanded menu tree as shown at the left, normally on the home page of the system. So we'll go to system config and go into the TDM map area of the system. And this shows time slot activity. For any encoding module, this is where we can connect our streams to the system. For the outbound transmission of a simulcast audio, it's important that the synchrocast data from the GPS also be paired with the voice channels that we're trying to time align in the field. By bundling these into one common stream, and when they're played out at the other end of the system, when the synchrocast data is decoded and then time aligned on the play outside of the field shell, the audio will also be time aligned with it. So any synchrocast or simulcasting voice channels need to be in a common stream with the synchrocast module. Everything else is easy. Yes?
So if you had another VF four card that you wanted to add to that, would you just put it then in like time slots 10, 11, 12, and 13? So that
yes.
You, okay.
You can just change the parameters of that encoded stream to encapsulate more channels of interest, and then you could have more outbound channels.
So you
could do 23 streams
of
synchrocast. 23 time slots of synchrocast could be possible in any bus. Yes. You would make them individual streams as you quickly run out of some other capacity in the shell. The outbound capacity is about four buses worth of IP traffic. So if you encoded one set of 23 time slots in single cast four times, you filled up the outbound capacity of the logic. How many 23 channel simulcast systems are there? All right.
So another question would be, that's obviously one site that you're going to with that stream.
Not necessarily.
Okay.
That could be a multicast channel. A multicast stream encapsulating those four channels going to every site. And if it's a 12-site system, and one of those time slots is our little contact card, then you've got site control of each one in the multicast stream as well.
So multicast, okay, so let's, if multicast wasn't available, you could set up another stream with two or three additional channels and also use a synchrocast?
Yes.
Append a synchrocast time slot, or you want to call it. Sorry.
Yes, they need to be adjacencies, but if you have this group of four channels intended to go out to radios at multiple sites, you can send a stream that grabs time slot 5 through 9, create a stream, send that to destination 1, create another transmit stream, grabs those same time slots and sends it to another second without multicast. We call that multi-unicast. So the same information again. And you can make as many copies of those 5 time slots as would fill up either the 4 TDM buses of outbound, or we hit a 32 stream limit, which is our table of streams.
So, okay, so you're talking about transmit only streams, not
after long, yes. So for encoding, because we wouldn't need the single cast reference on the received side coming back from loading. We would have discrete streams coming back from each site. So if this is 4 channels at 3 sites, we could play this one out 3 times to the field and bring back 4 channels from one site there, 4 channels from another site onto this card, and there's your 12 return voted services and done in 6 streams. It's one way of doing it. The stream creation process that we'll go through next and describe what your controls or capabilities are in working with the streams. It's when you create a new stream on the system, you have a dialog to show that. Not yet. It's further down in the system, I guess. It'll come to the stream's summary page, which is where you normally begin on a stream creation process. But it first pops up a step one. It's like, what type of stream do we want to make? The two stream types, of course, are TDM to TDM, not the default, but you can stream from the bus local system out to a physical T1 or T1 connection, or back in from that T1 onto this bus as a destination. So you can't do simulcast or synchrocast decode or receive from a T1 interface because we don't have a delay buffer involved in a TDM to TDM transfer. The simulcasting or synchronizing aspect of the bus is achieved with the Ethernet jitter buffer. So if we're doing a TDM to Ethernet stream on the receive side there, we can manually control where the jitter buffer will play out. That's where we do the time alignment with GPS.
Excuse you, Tom, for a second. When you wrap up, would you please bring the video camera and stand down to my booth?
Sure.
Just so it's not that different. Thank you very much, Lou. Enjoy all.
Thank you. Ed. So the first thing is really assign a familiar name to this site, like site 1 data or reference or segment or something, and make it a TDM 5 stream in a transmit mode, because we want to emanate from this box out to the field. That's our first challenge. I think that's how we begin this sequence, but maybe it's a receive stream. But you can see, just toggle this button here, if it's a receive stream or a transmit stream. We don't want to check both because our bandwidth will be different for the outbound simulcast stream carrying data, and what we need to bring back is at least one time slot smaller, and maybe fewer if you don't have all those channels to deploy yet.
Jeff, real quick,
Yeah.
Is repeat what you said about the TDM, you can't use synchrocast with the TDM, or it's a different method?
In the NetExpress, unlike the T1 multiplexer, we don't have a time delay buffer when we receive data off the T1 interface and play it onto the local TDM bus. There is no time delay that we can control there. It's just instantaneous in a single frame passed to the next destination. In our T1 multiplexers, we have a differing channel module that goes in called the CM5TD time delay, and that passes all the received traffic first through up to 84 millisecond buffer that we can control. And there's no buffer built into the NetExpress on a TDM to TDM transfer. You can play out from the NetExpress toward T1 connected field sites, but you cannot decode or delay the receive side of the NetExpress. The next selection that you're offered here is whether it's unicast or multicast or multi-unicast. Multi-unicast, you can select here and it will walk you through going really the same as just creating a singular one and you just make a duplicate. You still have to go through the same steps, but they've offered the amendment here to maybe create up to four. They thought it would be handier or easier to comprehend. But the primary selection here is multicast or unicast. Unicast is the default. A lot of services just don't tolerate multicast within them, so that's not a signaling support, if you need to use E and M to key anything in either direction. On the transmit side, I do have it enabled here. And if you do select a voice module, that's going to affect the idle code that's used when a stream goes down. The only reason for selecting something here is that different modules in the shelf have a different output presented depending on what they receive for data in, and the voice modules rest at a full one. So all one signal would normally be played on a T1 if it's down or idle. And so that's what the quiet mode of a voice module is. Whereas a data module, you might want zeros presented to it in the idle state. You can actually put in your own decode value there if it's a custom module. But the reason for a voice module selection is only to affect the stream down code value that's presented to the module. And the signaling pipe also is different from the various modules. If you select a V40, it's again a slightly different code because that's a 2 ENM module. And again, these options only show up when you enable voice signaling as a service. Another concern with enabling voice signaling on the bus or on the stream is the Simulcast module itself. This is not a typical view that you will see in the shelf. When properly set up, the Simulcast card with a signaling system cannot occupy a 64K time slot. And the TDM bus view of the system will only show green as in detecting bus activity if a full 64K channel is being presented to the bus. If we leave the Simulcast card set to 64K, then the signaling bit insertion will contaminate the data at the receive side, trying to follow the GPS tracking information. So we must run the Simulcast module at less than 64K time slot. And various options are 32, 16, or 8. It doesn't affect your resolution of the simulcast. It just affects how much data is presented onto the bus at any instant time. But the bus map here will show a blank on slot 5, and it's less visually effective than me forcing it to 64 just for this screenshot. So normally time slot 5 there, if that's the Simulcast card, will be white, even though this is the encode side where it's presented data onto the bus. So we've set that to less than 64K, so that the signaling byte insertion, or signaling bit insertion that happens at the T1 will not contaminate the data that's inserted in there. But we are contaminating the time slot in the audio domain. Every 12th frame will have a signal bit in there, just like a physical T1. Or sixth frame. Okay, now actually, to get to Ethernet side, we need to give it a destination IP address that needs to be visible or accessible from the WAN interface. So the IP address scheme that you chose to assign to the port on this box, it'll be either within that subnet or something that's routable from that subnet. And route statements can be added to the system elsewhere under our forwarding table. But the destination IP is affecting on the WAN interface. We do not stream on the LAN or the management port. There is an instance where the LAN can be used for link redundancy, but normally it's WAN subnet that we're dealing with here. UDP ports need to be unique for any IP address. So this post-end, we need to start off at the system wants you to start at 50,000. It's not critical. We start at 50,000 just to be up away from other known services, but you can choose whatever you like. In fact, the base port can also be started at another beginning or base address. But pick a unique value, and we don't need to set the source and destination to be the same, just for ease of traceability. As you look at the stream at the destination side, you can then easily map it to the one it came from in the host end of the system. So pick a unique number. If you have two that are conflicting, you will either contaminate the arriving data at the destination site by the two streams arriving and playing data onto that IP destination at the same time. On the encode side, it will warn you that that IP address is unavailable and you can't bring that stream up to the service. Loss of service priority, if supported in your network, will affect your delivery of the streaming content. It can be used to help prioritize other services on your network so that the stream services don't get second place or second rate to somebody downloading the file. If loss of service is recognized in the switch, then you just need to get that matching code selected onto the stream. Our normal position here is already IP prioritization over base services. I believe it's a COS 1 if you select normal. COS high is COS, high stream is COS 5. And if you select medium or low, then that's COS 0, which would be falling into the background of all other services on the switch. If the switch or router doesn't recognize class of service, then this doesn't influence anything. By default, normal is our home, and it will be tagged as COS 1, whether the switch pays attention or not. The other reason for this class of service priority, though, is to affect the alarming capability of the stream. If the stream goes down as a normal style, that's a major alarm condition as opposed to a minor alert. If you select high, it's also a major, but you can reduce the criticality of the streams by calling it a medium service. In that case, that won't be an alert on the system. If that particular stream is missing packets, it may not page you or call for panic help, but indicate that the stream is down in a softer fashion. If you select low, no alarm is generated. It's logged in the alarm table, but it will not light up the contacts on the backend system or the power supply indications on the shelf. So you can use class of service for different. That doesn't preclude you from still tagging those all as a particular class of service. If all your streams still need to be tagged as COS2 for the switch to recognize it, you can set all of these elsewhere in the system to indicate COS2, whether it's an alarming major, minor, or no alarm under this guide here of stream style. Egress IP, time to live. This is kind of don't care. This is how many hops the packet will survive through your network before being discarded as just parent to just taking a bandwidth. 64 is a big number, but it's the default value on the system. You figure if you're going through five hops, that's quite a route for your stream traffic, but maybe it's necessary, and if you have fewer than that, your packets won't get through, depending on the network architecture. 64 is there just to make sure it always gets through. But if you are more critical in your routing, you can reduce that to whatever is necessary for hop count of the packet. Step four here is where we actually select the bus and the time slot information of interest. We've already chosen the name, but choose the TDM source bus or destination bus if it's a unreceived stream. The starting channel, oh, I clicked on it as though it was the actual web page. The starting channel here is showing one, the range of one. These are the default values that the system is going to present to you every time you create your stream, even if one is already assigned with these parameters. They are only default values. They are not a guide of what to use for the system. In fact, 200 samples off the bus before closing the packet count is going to cause a stream delay that jitter buffer depth of half a second, effectively. And that's not what we want to deal with. That's way too long, especially for a loaded received stream. It's just abominable. typical value for your stream power. Again, I'm jumping ahead. These are the default values, but it's not what you want to be encouraged to use. 32 packet buffer. We want to discuss these are the topics, though. Your range here is 8 in multiples of 2, 16, 32, 64, 128. That's all you can choose. But if you're out at 128 packet buffer, you've got some real time to deal with. But only because we've sampled 200 GDM frames. This is our 8,000 samples per second. So 200 samples, that's 40 packets a second. So that's why 16 packets B is already 0.4 seconds of delay. But these values are all here for you to add. A more typical value we would use is 50 frames per packet. To get to a manageable granularity of package size and efficiency, because the more packets per second we send, the smaller this number we get of samples, the more packets we're going to send per second, the packet overhead will skyrocket. The system will allow you to deliver the packets at the TDM sample rate. If you choose one frame, it will generate 8,000 packets a second. Conversely, it's pumping out 4 megabits per second for no reason. But your traffic will get through at the rate of the T1. We can't expect that performance out of our Ethernet infrastructure to transport that much information. So bundling up these samples from the frame is our way of building a package and managing our overhead. If you've chosen a voice or a telephony stream that has a long delay, like those default values, there is a warning that that's going to probably induce some major echo problems if it's a bidirectional circuit. So, I mean, if it's a two-wire circuit. So they warn you that that's typically not used for a pulse module. But if you can use the decider, it's just a warning. Once you've established the values that through the walkthrough of the system, you've got 4 choices at the bottom. And I would encourage you to use the create button instead of create and activate. The reason being that if you create and activate the stream and there's a parameter there that is in conflict with an active stream, the stream will not activate, but it also will not create. And you've gone through these steps and lost your details. It will not save the process. By pressing create, it always lets you create duplicates of existing streams. But since it's not trying to actually run them on the bus or take resources to achieve that, then you can edit them after the fact. So then you get the chance to activate them individually and see which ones fail after the fact. So those are your choices. Start time slot, source bus or destination bus, multicast or unicast. A lot of the other choices in there you can ignore. The time to limit is not important. The prioritization for a lot of these networks isn't implemented or is not yet to be implemented. So you can ignore those values. Just get select unique or meaningful UDP ports so that you can look back at the information and recognize what it's also going to be carrying, because you can look at this information on Etherill or Wireshark, and I usually assign a site or destination number, followed by which stream it is, and then my last bit gives me an indication of whether that's an outbound or a receive stream. So I go 10 and 15 is the first stream from one site, and 20 and 25 is the next, or stream 2 for that particular site. And then I use the upper numbers to indicate which site it is. So you basically glance through the UDP ports and identify which site that traffic is on and filter them on a Wireshark capture. It just helps me keep everything manageable if you get up to multi-site systems.
Is there some reason the ports have to end in 0 or 5?
I'd be fine.
Is there a reason the ports have to end in 0 or 5?
There is a reason. They don't actually use groups of 5, but they use sometimes 2 and 3 adjacent ports So although you've selected a base port of 50,005, if you turn on forward error correction for the stream, then those packets will be carried in an adjacent time slot as opposed to neighboring packets so that they are arriving at the same time or intermixed with the source packets. So I know they at least use three UDP ports in the group. I think the others are reserved for maybe something that are enhanced, but they figured slicing into fives kept it simple enough.
Okay.
So adjacent ports are used. I believe it will permit you to assign a base differently, but don't use adjacent stream time slots. Keep the space, even if you want to use an ending of 04 for everything.
Gotcha.
Because you will step on those other stream actions. Any other questions?
Jeff?
Yes?
So in your screens, you're showing, you know, like the defaults out of the box. So do you have a chart that shows what we should set them for? Well, you know, like, for example, you know, on your screen, you have the default for forward error correction, you know, but what should we set it for? Or should we leave it none, or should we turn it on?
Well, initially, I would recommend for forward error correction specifically, leaving it off will give you a better indication of what the performance of the network actually is when you first try to turn on that stream. If you've got forward correction already turned on full, it will use twice the bandwidth necessary to transport that traffic and won't give you a clear indication of how reliable that service is because you'll only get a clue of a missing packet when you lost the ability to correct the packet. So starting with no forward regression, turning on the screen, and then looking at the performance statistics, it will show you how many missing packets or losses you have. If you're having singular lost packets, then low forward error correction should be able to heal that because it will patch a singular missing packet on that adjacency. If you have more than a single packet missing, full error correction may achieve it, but only if you're up to three consecutive packets. Beyond that, you can't fix it anyway. But you wouldn't get a good idea of whether you've got singular or doubles missing right away if you had started without forward error correction. Don't mask the network's fault up front, but use the tool to heal it if necessary on a stream-by-stream basis.
Okay.
If you suspect that the network could error because it is a wobbly, you know, transmission link or something like that, then turning it on after the fact is a good assurance that if you do get a new critical or marginal transport, that it'll suck. Low FEC to heal the one packet will use 50% more packet overhead, and full error correction to heal three consecutive will use twice the bandwidth. So again, these are the default values that produce a stream if you just click next, next, next. And that's how I build streams. I launch the stream add button and click next, 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 because I want to work from this page when I'm done and edit these values on the summary view. Once you've created a stream, as long as you've not recreated the unique name that says your name here, then you can build a set of streams and then tailor each one in an edit fashion, because there will be an apply button at the bottom of this screen as well to make changes from. I just find it easier to work from this screen for the streams than the walkthrough dialog, because you only are presented with a walkthrough dialog when you first deploy the system. Forever after, you'll be working from these screens to edit the streams. And so the walkthrough sequence is out of the normal flow of this page, and I find it distracting to switch gears like that. This is the familiar view, whether you jump to a NetExpress or M1 or CM30, they'll send you the summary page this way. But again, we're back to 200 frames per packet, 40 packets a second with a big chunky delay that we're not interested in. There's more typical setup for a simulcasting stream where you specify your time slot range. I'm starting on 6, which I don't know why. This must have been my receive stream. This is my voting stream. Time slot 6 was one of my voice channels coming back. And that first VF25 module on bus 1A. Just the same time slot, 50 frames, puts my stream delay at 30 milliseconds, so it's easily within the capture range of the voter. Even if it's slipped and recentered, it's always not to fall out of the tolerance of the voter's analog. Losing tone, so I don't have voice signal turned on the screen. But these numbers are fully flexible. We give you the granularity of the screen to control the delay and the bandwidth by making this packet, the number of samples within the packet, larger. Of course, I'm going to be more efficient, and therefore the total bandwidth will be reduced. I'm just a little more efficient on the network. If we shrunk it down to a very low frame per packet, then the stream bandwidth will skyrocket because we'll be putting 64 bytes on top of each sample that we've just doubled to the floor.
Suggest a unique subnet that resides for the higher QoS.
If the network is supporting that, by all means, you know, take advantage of it and use the quality of service tagging that's on the packet. So that you wouldn't necessarily need any bottom account. Either way, both methods, segregating the subnet, helps to isolate your personal traffic from the rest of the environment. But quality of service, if supported at the switches, and rarely can you. In phone calls, I find that rarely the installer has the ability to talk the infrastructure people into getting quality service support on switches. The switches either predate it, actually, or they don't want to bother with it, you know, and they will give them just a group of address ranges to work within, and there is no quality service in there. So the management, they might want to put on a separate subnet so that you don't conflict with your own streams when trying to work with the boxes in the field. But you can browse into the system, if enabled, through the streaming interface. The WAN port will serve a web page just like the management port. So if you just have a one connection to the site, class of service then on the streams could be important so that you're browsing in or FTPing the new upgrade to the chassis wouldn't interfere with the live stream. FTP would be the bottom of the hell. Streams would still have their CLS one.
So you have three networks?
There are three interfaces. Typically only the management port for direct connection, and it's often left at the default address so that someone arriving at site can just plug directly in it and know that it's at the initial default address. If your network has multiple connections and they are discrete connections to the switch, then yes. So long as those interfaces aren't plugged into a common switch so that they don't see each other short-circuited on the management WAN connection, you actually have them VLAN or LAN separately, then yes, you can service
the port.
Yes, I'm pretty sure we have support for it. It's done on another screen. I don't even have to even have that screen available here. We can see that the booth on the actual box.
How about grades on that 50?
We also use SMPV2, so there's no security there either. So lock down your networks. The box won't lock down for you. We're getting some pressure for that too. So at some point, we're going to start employing some more robust solution, yeah, there are three interfaces. The LAN interface, although present, its real intent was for a specific link aggregation function or a separate connection to the house network, so you could have it on yet another discrete subnet and access the box locally. This is a routing mechanism, so the concern without any outside router or firewall protection for the locks is that LAN traffic can be forwarded on toward the WAN in search of its destination. So you get errant traffic flowing through there if you are connected on the LAN, except it's set up for redundancy, which is its one major forte, is that you can have a shared bandwidth connection with the same IP address, but that mechanism needs to be supported at the switch side of those cables and connections as well. So typically someone only connects to the WAN for final deployment or just the management and WAN connections are made, not for LA. By each interface, you have the granularity of different functions too. We would encourage, especially if you're exposing the box on a public forwarded address, that you disable SNMP and other services that you're not actually using. Even all the service, but HTTP could be shut off. And then if you do need to temporarily log in and upload or download a log file, turn on FTP temporarily. But there's a lot of bot traffic out there hitting just random switches and addresses. They troll all day long looking for something they don't know what to either use as a relay point into other services. Network forwarding is where you put your route table information. If you're trying to stream to a destination beyond the local subnet, certainly typical. You need to put the next hop or gateway information for each of those destinations in here. The system does not support DHCP, so your locally assigned WAN interface can only directly access its own subnet. So by default, you will see that there are entries in the forwarding table, but they are just the local interface scope. If you've got a standard net mask, then the subnet is defined as that local IP address range. So that's those are the only default destinations that could be streamed to until you add forwarding information. So extra entries are not uncommon to be required in the table for the LAN streaming. And same for management. If you need to get through a gateway back to the main control point or monitoring station. Back into streaming. This is the streams page. In the left-hand column, you'll see it's about the fifth item down on the left. And there's no submenu below it. It just takes you to this one dialog that will list the up to 32 created streams that you have in the system. Insert state will be listed and whether they actually succeeded or not in this adjacent column. If it was in service and yet didn't succeed, then it would actually be red, not just yellow, indicating it's temporarily turned off, but available. Timing streams, synchronicity is important in the transfer of the data. So it will, on the field side, often be a stream assigned to derive the clock off the arriving packet station rate. And so one of your streams, usually the one with the higher packet rate, or the lower frames per packet selection, so it is generating the most ticks into the box will be used for your timing source just to ensure stability of the other streams. Also, E&M service on a stream is indicated by the little telephone. This one's actually up and receiving its E&M information or E output information from the arriving stream. These are bi-directional, so we don't really have any status about the outbound traffic. When you turn on a transmit-only stream, so long as the next hop or the local gateway is found, the stream will indicate up. If it's a bidirectional stream, then it won't indicate up until it actually is also past satisfactorily receiving traffic from the opposing side. So building discrete transmit and receive streams gives you more information. So long as you have enough room in the streams table, you'll get more information about which direction our stream is having trouble, because quite often a failed stream that is bidirectional is really only failing in one of the two directions, but the stream will just say down and you don't quite have a clue as to which direction is that falling. This page looks an awful lot like the performance page on the system where you look at stream quality. And so there'll be a list of streams again and stats regarding received or sent packets, lost packets, all that information. And of course you'll often come here and want to know, well, how's it doing now? So you'll clear out the stats page and then wait for a few more statistics to come in and see if it's running clean. To clear out the stats, you click the clear all button up here and then erases all the current stats. But if you do it on this page, it looks almost identical to the statistics page. You just deleted all of your streams off the box. Hopefully restore the archive.
Jeff, I think I'll add a little bit to your presentation. I do a lot of this, and one of the great tools for me is having two screens on my workstation and have each end of the stream up.
Right.
Because there can be conditions, just like you said, where one side will say up and the other will say in progress or down. If you're using a post-stage.
Yep.
The other thing that's real important is that refresh gizmo up at the top and what that does.
Right. When you first land on the page, it will request the web page from the chassis, giving you the current view of the system. Up here, there is an auto refresh of just this dial. If you press refresh on your browser, you're back at the home page, because this is a frame within the server page. So the whole frame refreshes and you're back at the home view. But within each dialog, you'll find a manual refresh request. So you can press M and get a local refresh of just these pages or this information. But 5 or 10 or 30 second auto refresh can also happen there while you go and look at the other side on another window or another browser. That's where it's also on the stats page, the performance statistics page as well, which is the next item down, which is probably why they stylized them the same. It's just don't believe the machines. But quite often you want to fill them all out at the same time, and that's the danger. And both pages also prompt you with, are you sure, that you get into the habit of just always acknowledging that irritating are you sure button. That's where the danger lies, in just deleting your streams. In the performance streams, you'll get an indication of how many late or under run packets showed up. If their lates are underruns, that means they arrived, but they were too delayed to be useful. So a deeper jitter buffer running for that particular network performance would have probably captured them in time to play out. But they did show up. They weren't not lost in the network, but they were not useful because they were too late from the target playout time. The current buffer depth is shown on the performance. So in a 32 packet buffer, your starting point will be half of that buffer. So if you choose 32 or 16, your starting point is half of that packet depth. Just to give you an idea of how your stream delay is computed, it's the number of packets. So if you're doing 40 frames a packet, it's 0.025 or a 40th of a second. So a 32 packet buffer, you're going to have 16 packets ahead of playout time. That's how you come up with the 425 seconds of delay if you're supposed to be following this. Yeah, this is the NetExpress view, and this is the Simulcast view. This is this detail view. If you click on the button up to the left, this will pop you into the last 10 second samples in time for that particular stream. So there's more behind, you know, within this summary page. And that will give you instantaneous values as opposed to this long history. So you can drill down without clearing the overall stats and just see what's going on now. Actually building the streams for Simulcast operation. This is an easy way to, without getting into too much into excess detail on how to use the system, you can just pick up each of these time slots and span the number of time slots of interest. If you're just trying to transport from one channel system to a few different sites, then you can start with, the first sample I showed you, where we just simply pick up five time slots and send them everywhere, of course, is carrying the same content to every location. It gets in the way of discrete audio within each site, which some of the other installed architectures prefer. They want the ability to adjust the injection level at the control point. And you can do that on your equipment outside of the audio that's being presented to the multiplexer. But only if you're just sending discrete audio to each of the locations. If we're doing encode once and sending that same content everywhere, that's really encouraged for Simulcast perspective because you eliminate a lot of distortion or deviation among channels, any differences that might happen among the various ADD ingest for the various modules. There will be some differences there. They're close, but they won't be identical. We sample once at the ingest and send those same channels everywhere, and you've eliminated a lot of distortions that could have shown up in the system. The drawback is that you don't have discrete side-by-side keying for each of those channels or the audio control that someone would have preferred. So if you want to bring in a discrete audio to each site, we still have the problem of keeping that single cast data adjacent to or efficiently adjacent to the transport audio. For a single channel, it's not really much of a problem because we can send two time slots to one of the sites, send three time slots to the next site. Similar in perspective to this one, it was edited differently. You can just ban the number of time slots you need to distribute the audio to a site. But if you're doing a single channel to various sites, you can pick up two channels and send it to the first site. The second site could just span the Simulcast data, the adjacent time slot that it's not interested in, and the target time slot for the next site and call that three time slots to the next site. So site two would actually transport three time slots. The next site out would need more bandwidth to carry that one channel because it's also now carrying two excess channels. But it's a simple way to deploy a low channel count set of streams to the field and give you discrete audio input to each one. There's a more bandwidth efficient method possible with NetExpress. But for the LX chassis, this is really the easiest way to go. Another option is to place voice module on the other side of the Simulcast module. So you could grab four channels on this side, four channels leading that. That's why this one's on time slot 5 to begin with. It gave me room for another four voice channels preceded with Simulcast reference. So I could grab channels ahead of it and channels after it. This could be a one site, this could be up to four channels to another site. So for two sites, I get as many as I want across the bus just by expanding outward from the Simulcast data. I hope I'm not jumping around too much in the concepts, but there's a lot of ways to build these streams depending on what your requirements are for channel count and site count. And I was trying to present it in a sequence that seem to build on itself. In the NetExpress, the large NetExpress, you get a view of active stream services. your physical time slot will be resident in the first six physical slots of the system with access to bus 1A and 1B, and conversely, slots 6 through 12, 7 through 12, the second group is TDM 2A and 2B. So that's where your physical cards are sitting. And the idea is to map these out to the real world. So a time slot mapping has appeared in the system called the media switch map. It wasn't available at the earliest NetExpress and is not available in the CM30 yet. We've asked for it. In the CM30, you can only take one source channel and distribute it to the field four times. It has the same architecture here with four IP destinations per time slot available in the matrix or the logic of the system. But in the NetExpress, this is all dynamically allocated resource now. If you turn on a stream, it will find room in the matrix over here to fit that stream. If it's too long or too wide of a span to fit in that bus, it'll jump to the next bus or find a hole or a gap between existing streams to utilize that function. So if we've got channel cards thrown in the system, as we have been showing on the earlier slides, Simulcast on 5 and 3 voice modules in the system. Here's how the live media switch should show up if we built all the streams to connect those to the outside world. Stream 2 here shows that it's sourced from bus 1A, starting on 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So it's coming from this group here. This is my encode audio to the world. Stream 3 is using the same encode information. Stream 4 is using the same ground on the bus. Coming home from the field, I've got stream 6 coming in and landing on these from the outside world, four time slots wide. Stream 7 is four time slots wide. So these are the vote returns from three sites and four channels. The media switch map shows you the active services consuming the resources and what's left over for available connections. This is six locations, room for two more sites. We're not going to run out of IP connectivity here, but we're going to run out of physical channel card space in the shelf. The voice modules, we only have 12 slots, and to bring home a couple more sites is going to run out of physical channel space and blocks. Again, this is still encode once. We want discrete audio to each location. And in the simple architecture, we can just transport the ignored time slot to each field site. In this type of a build, it's encouraged that the co-located site or the nearest site be the highest bandwidth one so that you don't carry that excess data out to the farthest reaches of the environment. Keep the skinny ones for the far remote sites. But by the same token, you can build it both directions around that single cast card. You make two time slot streams, so those are ultra efficient. There's no excess transport involved there. By picking up 4 and 5 and 5 and 6, then you just can sync and audio to the field. Make sure that it plays out in the field sites in the same fashion. If you've encoded it with sync preceding audio, then it can't play out like this other stream where voice is preceding the sync module, because when it arrives in the field, we have the same receive stream architecture where we have a beginning time slot and a range. That's all we can specify. There's no slots to skip or reverse sequence to play. But this does give you the ability to bring in EMM keying discrete to each site and audio to each site if you're using contacts built into the voice module for transport. It's also important to not push the time slots around. We have a lot of capability, not just to move laterally across the bus here with our time slot activity, but to misalign our audio with our voice. For every site, we need to keep the relationship with the Simulcast reference and the encoded audio the same when they arrive in the field. You don't want the voice playing out in a different fashion. This runs into a big issue with people running on a T1 system with a cross-connect, because they have all these time slots available, and they'll just throw the audio on the channel card, and in some cases, the data is arriving later than the voice audio that they place it on the bus. And by doing so, you don't just move it a couple time slots before, but it has, internally, it ends up playing out a full frame length, because it cannot play backward in time. It's a sequential encode, so it's a sequential decode or play out at the receiving location. The reason for sliding the single cast card down the bus is so that we can make room ahead of it and after it for picking up additional time slots. For a single channel, and this can be expanded easily, but don't let the single channel architecture here throw it in. The reason for building it this way is so that we can easily change each one to 2, 3, or 4 channels per site without any interference. But we start off with this layout, and we stream that pair of channels to one location. Build the stream to specify 2 time slots and send it out there. It was built with the voice leading the audio, and the next stream here is the The second one created is the data leading the audio. The first one, the audio, is leading the data. So when they play out in the field, that site needs to have its channel cards installed in the same fashion for proper operation. But we can only do that once, since the stream only allows us to specify one bus, a starting time slot, and a range. This single guest card has dollar signs associated with it. This one piece of the system is the price of the chassis. So if we can make reuse of that card, it's in our best interest. But there's no more adjacencies that we can pick up here from this one installed single cast card. We could put another single cast card into the other bus and do the same thing. But the large NetExpress allows us to do other tricks. You can build only 2 copies with adjacent voice signals. But if we send the synchrocast reference out the physical T1 ports on the NetExpress, then we can bring them back in on a loopback plug and reutilize that original synchrocast reference. The GPS timestamp that's coming in can be paired up with other voice channels by sending those also out the T1 interface. So by pairing them that way, now we can pick up time slots that are now adjacent again to the synchrocast reference. We can build an IP stream that starts here and goes to the field, and starts here and goes to the field, to get us up to 6 sites with 1 to 4 channels. And there's no excess bandwidth sent out to the field with any of these streams. They're all bandwidth efficient. And we made 3 copies of the synchrocast card on the bus, but we're using it 6 times. If you're not on the buying side of the synchrocast card, its list price is $4,000. So building 2 copies internally to the shelf is important, because you can buy on the shelf for that.
The buffer issue with the T1 doesn't matter, because you're coming back and regenerating that data.
Yes, the timing of this head-end chassis is providing the T1 clock to the T1s. This would be externally timed to the synchrocast card, so everything leaving this box is at that time reference, so the arriving T1s are in sync. By sending the synchrocast data out the T1 and the voice out the T1, they're both arriving delayed by the same amount as well, so we haven't incurred any overall. It's just part of the added network. These do take longer to get to the field, but the field unit will take care of that for us.
So, are you using the logical loopback built in, or are you using a physical,
plug on the back of the system. show an alert condition indicating there's a temporary loop backup. And those temporary loops, I don't believe, are sustained in a reboot. Plug in with that plug. The NetXpress wasn't actually shipping loopback plugs like the TDM shelf was. They are now. Didn't realize that someone would get, even from a pre-configured system that they've ordered, all the details are already loaded on the shelf, but when you go fire up, everything goes red. There's nothing's leaving the box. The T1s are down until they plug in their own T1 plugs. So those are shipping now on the back of the line, the MIU. That additional chassis, of course, now is delayed differently than the module we might be introducing at that chassis. Taking into account that extra delay process, you could reuse that signal that's shown for the next 2 months out. If you're saying the same thing, right? Just to cross over the cable.
Yeah.
That would be a manual, isn't it?
Yeah, there's a manual frame delay, of course, involved in getting that. Oh, if you bring it into that shelf, what do you do in that shelf?
Well,
if it's a co-located transmitter, you could delay that shelf there. Yes, you should be able to reuse it on a TDM relay like that, bringing it into another NetExpress T1 interface instead of reusing it in this box, bring it onto another shelf and redistribute from there. But the original reference is now misaligned with the voice audio that you're starting off in those cascaded shelves. Now they're already offset by a piece of frame delay. So there's almost 200 microseconds loss. So if you take that into account and program those field sites to be 200 microseconds earlier or 192, it'll be okay. It's not actually 192 because there's still a T1 jitter buffer in the front of the CM5 and there's already N1 here. So you'd actually have to measure what your offset is in the staging. But it should be predictable.
So this might be a sort of a newbie question, but the SynchroCast module is obviously at the head end to generate the streams, but you also, at the remote site, you can't just use an LX frame.
Yes, you can. Yes, the LX in the field site works with the SNC-101T transmitter site module. And adjust the timing of the jitter buffer on that received stream that has that card emitted. So it's quite common to have a NetExpress at the prime site in order to do some manipulation of the installed time slots and use the CM30 base shelves in the field.
So there's a pairing card in the receive side or the transmit sites that receives that SNC time slot.
Yes, it plays out onto, it needs to be assigned to the bus that stream with the voice module is also playing out to. So it would be physically the same architecture that you encoded it. So if you've got adjacent slots or specific time slot arrangement, set up the field site to be exactly the same physical architecture and logical architecture so the stream plays out exactly as we encoded. Then the SynchroCast 101T card compares the GPS at that site with the data that came in the stream and measures the difference in value. If it's leading or lagging, it will then start to slew the received jitter buffer for that stream until it's not that one to match the requested time delay. That's the whole purpose of this, is to get that piece of the operation satisfied with voice paired with data to make that adjustment.
So I know in my sort of EDAX world, you have a notion of hitless versus, as far as the timing transfer goes, is this sort of a timing that slowly occurs over a period, or is this like a...
On stream interruption or a newly restored stream, the system will operate in a hit fashion, hit-full fashion, whereas since the audio wasn't aligned anyway, you weren't hearing it right, it will try to jump to the nearest packet. So it will jump the jitter buffer from its natural center. When you first turn on the receive screen, it will assume in the middle of your jitter buffer, but if it then gets data that says, Simulcast says, move 7 milliseconds over here, then you will jump to the nearest packet in that move, and then it goes into the slower slew rate or speed rate. The hitless movement is 100 microseconds per second, but it will jump whole packets. So if you have small packets and not huge 200 frames per sample, then the out of sync time on a hit stream that had to recover will be very short because it will jump to the target and then have very little time to traverse to get actually to complete one. The 50 frames per packet that we've chosen is only to get the computed stream to a logical number of 50 milliseconds for a 16 packet buffer, or 100 milliseconds for a 32 packet buffer, just to be a nice natural round number to work with. You don't have to worry with those values. Anything your network can tolerate can be used for a stream delay, but you want to choose your Simulcast target delay based on the achievability of these stream rates through your network. If you find you have to push everything out further, don't just adjust the one on the T card to be later in that buffer, but tune the buffers so that they will wake up as close to that value as possible, and that will keep your out of sync time reduced to a minimum. That's why you don't have to use round numbers. You can trim a certain site to be 53 frames per packet or something, so it will always end up where your network will try to achieve it. Because we don't know what the actual propagation to the site is. These stream delay values are purely the box-to-box plus buffer values, not the network itself. Streams just requires consuming more actual streams. copies without the T1 copy, but we still use the T1. Bring the time slot reference, time slot 1, over to the T1 bus along with the voice channel and send out as many channels as you need out of the T1 and bring them back and send out to the field. For the first stream, you don't even need to use the T1 bus because they're naturally grouped already. For the second stream, if we wanted to pick up this time slot here and start on our second group, we'd send time slot 1, and the Simulcast input is now sitting up here over that time slot 1. Send it out to T1 way down here so that it is preceding the voice channel of interest, and then send those voice channels out to T1 and pick them up from there. So we wouldn't just move everything across the bus. We would skip as many channels as we need to get to the next available time slot, send a copy of sync up the T1, move the voice channels across the bus and send them out flat. This Simulcast reference has now advanced the bus by 6 time slots, advanced by 5. Now, if you go here, I've only advanced by 4. Take that into account when you play out your voice in the field, because each time slot is another 500 microseconds of shift. If you advance the time slot, they add up fast. We've gone forward 20 microseconds already. We haven't even gotten the launch. So by the time you get to the end of the bus, you will have advanced many, many time slots. And you have to take them into account, just tell the site out there to hold off before releasing that site to make up for the lead in the encoded data so that it matches the voice. You cannot go backward in the bus, though. You have to bring them from a smaller time slot down the bus. If the Simulcast was here, I cannot play it into time slot 4, 3, 2, or 1, because they won't actually leave until they or be picked up off the bus until a frame later. So always advance forward on the bus. But that allows you to build any group of streams. This was natural for that particular application, because it was only a 4-site system, but it becomes cumbersome to try to do this if you don't have just a nice 4-channel card fitting a 4-channel application. For 3 channels, this is going to waste the time slot on either end that we can't actually get to for any purpose. So if you're doing 3 channels, you send the 3 channels to the field, start off on the 4th channel, bring the Simulcast down to meet it, and just take into account those 3 advanced time slots on the play on the field. Subtract the 50 microseconds on here. Now, Steve Paulson will give you a quote to have this done for you before you receive your shelf. We do offer programming ahead of time for someone who's cold on the system. It's nice to have at least one template pre-programmed so that you can build from there. Often just get a head-end unit programmed and one field or co-located box and the other 6 chassis just flat so somebody can take that initial one and do a backup restore onto the other units and just tune them as they wish. But it saves a lot of getting up to speed for somebody who's just starting off with deploying one of these. Once you've done it once or twice, it does start to make sense. I don't think I've been doing it for many years. Any other thoughts or questions come up about something I glossed over? Oh, we didn't really get into synchronicity, but since this is Simulcast, the GPS time field site is naturally going to use that, or you have to select it in the menu, but Simulcast is the timing mode for all the field shells that are receiving data from the Simulcast time. The head-end chassis can certainly hand off traffic to other boxes. In that case, the streams would be internally or GPS time in the head-end, and you would use stream time for the connected sites. So if you're bringing audio in from the sheriff's office into here before dispatch, you can just connect a raw stream and even use the default values if you don't care about the arising data, since it's not getting timestamped until it leaves this first box with the Simulcast 1 on its card. Now, we're just transporting simple circuits. services, this is a lot easier box to work with than trying to get time on the data.
Any other questions?
If you think of any questions, please visit us.